Is Jenkins relevant in 2021? Should you use it or should you not use it? Should you continue investing in Jenkins? Should you adopt it or should you just ditch it? I will not go through Jenkins in general. You know what it is. You know what it does. You know how it dominates the market or how it dominated the market. What I want to see is whether it is still relevant. And the best way to see whether something is relevant today is to put it inside of Kubernetes and see how well it behaves. So today we are going to go through some kind of mini tutorial and the review of Jenkins in Kubernetes within a context of 2021. Let's start with installation. How would we install Jenkins today inside of a Kubernetes cluster? I already have a repository, so I'm inside of that repository, Jenkins demo. Let's see what we should do. If you do a bit of Googling, you will discover that there is something called Jenkins operator. If you're familiar with Kubernetes, you would probably say, hey, Jenkins operator, that sounds great. And it does sound great, but unfortunately it isn't. It is still in early stages, it is buggy, it doesn't really work well, so I'm going to discard it. That's potentially a future. I know that community is about to put more effort into it, but for now I will ignore Jenkins operator. Simply, it's not there yet. It might be, but today it's not there. So we are going to fall back to a more traditional approach to installing something, which is Helm. I'm going to add the repository Jenkins CI, which is located in https charts.jenkins.io. I will quickly update the repo just to make sure that I have the latest of everything, including Jenkins CI. Now let's take a look at the values that we have, and I'm going to go to the Git repository where the Helm chart is maintained, and we can see the values over there. And I'm going to do that by opening the repo, which is gh repo view and then Jenkins CI slash Helm charts. Now let me pause here for a second. If you're confused with the command gh, that's GitHub CLI. If you're not familiar with GitHub CLI, you should be. And the link to the video is above my head somewhere, probably, and in the description of this video. And while I'm on the description of this video, it contains all the useful information, including the gist, the link to the gist with all the commands that I'm executing right now. So if you want to follow along or replicate what I'm doing, all the commands are in the gist. It's in the description. So let's see that repository from a browser. So that's the Dash web. Here we are, the chart is in charts Jenkins. And if we take a look at the values, we will see that there are values. And if you scroll and scroll and scroll and scroll and scroll and scroll, it's huge. That's because Jenkins is massive. The amount of things we can do with Jenkins is massive, which could be a good thing. Being massive has its advantages, but it also poses quite a few challenges. We're going to discuss those challenges later. I will leave you exploring the values yourself because I already prepared a values file that we are going to use today. So let's take a look, and it's in Jenkins values YAML. We're going to do the minimum necessary for this demo, and the minimum is that we need to enable ingress. I'm always surprised that ingress is not enabled by default in all the charts. That's kind of silly if you ask me. Anyways, we are going to enable ingress, and it will be enabled on this address, which is basically the IP of my load balancer going through NIPIO, and installed plugins. Now, those first four are plugins that would normally be installed with this chart by default, and I added Blue Ocean because Blue Ocean simplifies a few things and makes it a bit prettier. We are going to see it in a second. So we are going to execute Helm upgrade. Just in case you already have Jenkins chart there running, dash dash install. If it's not installed, we're going to call it Jenkins, and the chart is Jenkins CI slash Jenkins. The namespace will be, surprise, surprise, Jenkins, and we're going to create the namespace if it doesn't exist already. The values will be Jenkins values YAML, and we are going to wait until it is fully operational. This might take a couple of moments, so I will fast forward to the end of this process. That didn't take as long as I feared it would. Let's open it in browser. The address should be this one. So I'm going to open it. The username by default is always admin, and we need to discover the password. And the password is in a secret. So let me copy the command and paste it directly here. There we are. Let's sign in. Now, before we create our first job, and probably the only job in this video, there are some warnings. You can see them here. And it says the following installed plugins are deprecated. This is one of the things that shows the downsides of silliness of Jenkins. There are deprecated plugins that are packaged in the official chart managed by community. So why are you packaging something that is deprecated? And if you go to the red one, which is more serious, there's a bunch of warnings about plugins that are packaged by default. And I'm not talking about plugins that I installed. Those plugins come by default in the officially released Helm chart. And if you look at the last one, like Mercurial plugin 2.0, why is Mercurial plugin in Jenkins in the first place? It's 2021. Almost nobody uses Mercurial today, and it's definitely not the default choice. If you want Mercurial installed plugin and you're 0.001% of the users, please don't package something that almost nobody uses in an official release of an application like Jenkins. And when you package things that people do use, please make them up to date. Because I didn't get one warning. I got a bunch of warnings. So this is definitely not up to date. And I would need to go and manually upgrade the plugins on the first, on the initial installation. It's not that 3 months passed since I installed Jenkins. I just installed a fresh installation of Jenkins, and it's already not up to date. And it already contains deprecated things that shouldn't be there in the first place. Okay, happy thoughts. Calm down. Cool. I'm going to ignore the plugins issue altogether. We're going to talk about them later. Let's go to Blue Ocean and create our first job. So create new pipeline. I'm going to select GitHub, and I'm going to type my access token. I will not tell you what my access token is because I don't trust you yet. Here it is. I'm going to connect. This is kind of nice. This is streamlined. I like this. It makes it very easy to connect to a repository. I'm going to choose this organization. And then here is the list of repos, Jenkins demo. This is nice. This part of experience is really, really cool. Create pipeline, and that's about it. Now I have a pipeline, or I will have a pipeline in a couple of moments for my application, for my repository. Now that we are talking about the pipeline, let me show you the pipeline itself. Cut Jenkins file. Here it is. We are going to do some continuous delivery today, a simplified version. It will be just enough to see how Jenkins behaves in Kubernetes or in general. Here I'm defining that Kubernetes should be my agent. So the builds of this particular job will run in Kubernetes. There is YAML file, jenkins.pod.yaml. I will go through it later. For now, just think of it as a file that defines the pod with all the containers we will need. Then we have some environment variables. They're not that relevant for this conversation. And we have stages. Stages are groups of steps. So the first one will be build, and within the build stage, we have some steps, and we're going to run those steps in a container called Kaniko. I will show you what that container is. If you're familiar with Kaniko, you know what it does. Kaniko will build and push container images to a container registry, in my case, to Docker Hub. If you're not familiar with Kaniko, the link to the video is above my head, because Kaniko is most likely the tool you should be using to build your container images, not Docker. Docker does not work in Kubernetes anymore unless you do some dark magic. And then once the image is built and pushed to the registry, we are going to do a couple of things. We are going to run some tests, but we are going to run them only if there is a change request to the master, meaning that we are going to execute tests only if somebody creates a pull request that is mergeable to the master branch or to the mainline. And to run tests, we need to deploy that something. So we are going to create a namespace, a unique namespace for this project and this branch. We are going to go to the customize directory preview. I'm using customize. If you're not familiar with customize, there is a link to that video as well. And within customize manifests or customization.yaml, we're going to define the namespace to be whichever namespace we created before. We're going to set the image to be the image that we just built. And we're going to modify ingress YAML so that the preview of the application is deployed somewhere where it could be accessible. And from there on, we're going to build and deploy using Customize. And finally, we're going to wait until it rolls out. We're going to wait until the application is fully up and running. From there on, we are going to run some tests. I'm going to do some silly testing, not real testing. I'm going to send a URL request to the application because I was too lazy to write tests. But you would use this command to run tests yourself, whichever way you run tests. And we are going to delete the namespace once we are done. In other words, what we are doing here is creating a temporary namespace, deploying application, running some tests against that deployed application, then destroying the application as if it never existed. So it is temporary deployment for the sake of testing, and everything is destroyed at the end so that we do not waste resources. Now, you will notice that I'm not using Jenkins plugins here because I do not believe that plugins are a good idea, not in Jenkins, but almost anywhere. We should not rely on plugins. We should rely on commands that can be executed in more or less the same way in CI/CD pipelines or outside CI/CD pipelines from Laptop, for example. Ideally, I wouldn't even do it like this. I would create some test.sh, for example, command, and that would simplify my pipeline, but it would also simplify me doing the same tasks locally as well. But in this case, I didn't create a script. I put everything in a pipeline to have an easier time showing you how it would look like. The important conclusion of what I'm trying to say is for you not to rely on plugins and not to rely on special capabilities of a tool that does CI/CD pipelines. Instead, make sure that you create things in a scriptable way, that things are decoupled from pipeline type of tools so that you're not really dependent on them much and so that you can execute same things both locally and within pipelines. Anyways, we have one more stage, which is called deploy, and that stage will be executed only if you merge something or push something to the mainline. So we have temporary deployments and testing when we create a pull request, and then we have deployment to production when we merge that pull request to the mainline. And deployment to production is very similar to what we did before. I'm going to the production directory that contains customized manifests. Then I'm setting the image to whatever was the image that was built previously, and I'm applying those manifests. Now, there is one thing that I should say, that normally I wouldn't actually do the deployments in this way. I would instead clone a repository that defines specific environments. I would use Argo CD or Flux, but this is not a video dedicated to GitOps. This is a video purely about Jenkins running in Kubernetes, not Jenkins in general. But if you would like me to show you how to do GitOps style of deployments in Jenkins, let me know in the comments and I will do that as well. I will show you how to convert this into GitOps something. Now, if I go back to the top, you will remember that I mentioned Jenkins pod YAML. This is the YAML that defines the pod with the containers where all those steps will be executed. So let's take a quick look at that pod, and which is jenkinspod.yaml. And it is a typical standard definition of a pod. We have some containers. One is called shell. This is for random commands that I might execute in a container based on an Alpine image. And we have Kaniko image, which is over here. And we have customize, which is based on this image. Now, there are a couple of things important here. And the first one is that the command is always cut. And the reason for using cut as a command is because cut without an input would wait indefinitely. And then that container would not simply exit when it's finished doing what it's doing. It would stay there running for the duration of the job. And similarly, we have tty, which is enabled and set to true. Now, this should be defaults in Jenkins. I don't think that I should bother as a user to specify command cut. That should be the default setting. But hey, you cannot have it all. Anyways, for Kaniko to push images to a container registry, we need to mount a volume with a secret that contains credentials, in this case, the Docker Hub. And we are about to create that secret in a second. For now, just take a look that it is defined here. It is mounted as Kaniko secret. This is the directory that should be mounted. And here is the definition of the secret defined as a volume. I like that Jenkins is not reinventing the wheel. It is using standard pod definition to define all the containers required to run a job inside a Kubernetes cluster. So I like this. I like not reinventing the wheel when there is no good reason for that. Now let's create that secret. I will copy and paste the command because it's slightly longer than usual. I already have all the values in environment variables. The commands how to create them are in the gist, in the setup phase of the gist. Anyway, I'm creating the secret. And now that pipeline should have the information how to authenticate against the container registry, which in this case is Docker Hub. There is one more thing we need to do, and that's to set up roles and permissions in general. And here we are. I'm going to create a cluster role Jenkins that will give Jenkins permissions to do anything anywhere. That is probably too permissive. I wouldn't do it like that in a real world example, but for now, I just want to show you that we should have a role that defines what Jenkins can and cannot do, and then we are going to attach that role to all the jobs or some of the jobs based on this cluster role binding, which goes to the service account to Jenkins, which is the one used in the pod definition I just mentioned. Now let me apply this kubectl apply dash file name roles, so that roles are inside of the cluster. And we are left with only one more thing pending to do before our pipeline is fully operational, and that is to create a webhook. So I'm going to go to the repository ghrepo-view-web, and I'm going to choose the forked version of the repo. But before I do that, let me go back to the terminal. There is one thing that I forgot, and that is that I need this address. This is address of jenkins/github-webhook. That's the address where webhook should be sending requests to Jenkins to notify that there is something to be done. So to create a webhook, I will go to settings. I will go to webhooks. And I will create a new webhook or add a webhook. The URL should be that one. And the content type should be JSON. And I will configure it to send me everything, not me, to send Jenkins all the notifications about everything. And then Jenkins will decide when to act and then under which conditions it should do something or under which conditions it should do nothing. So adding the webhook, and hopefully everything works fine. We'll see that later. Now, this is kind of also missed opportunity. I could swear that creation of webhooks worked out of the box from Jenkins whenever we create a new job. But now either there is a problem with Jenkins and that doesn't work by itself, or it's not a feature anymore, and I don't like that. Or maybe we could make Jenkins do that somehow through a plugin, which I forgot the existence of such a plugin. Anyway, we're going to talk about plugins later. Now let's simulate the life of a developer. Now that everything is set up, Jenkins should do everything that needs to be done. And that should mean that we should now continue with our lives and do what we normally do. So let's say that I want to develop a new feature, and that would be first to git checkout -b my feature, right? I'm creating a new branch for a simulation of a development or something new. And I'm going to continue role playing by simulating change of, actually not simulating, changing the source code, but making some silly change. And I'm going to change something in config.toml. What should I change? Let's say I should change the subtitle to be, what should I put here? Maybe Jenkins in KTES in 2021. I'm going to save it, and we're going to add those changes, and we're going to commit those changes. Too lazy to write messages. And we're going to push those changes. Since we just created a new branch, we need to set upstream to be origin my feature. And now the changes to the source code are in a branch, but if you pay attention to Jenkins file, we are reacting only if a pull request is created or if a pull request is merged to the master branch, or if we push anything to the master branch or mainline. But this is neither of those two cases, so nothing happened just yet. So let's create a pull request with gh pr. What is the command? I forgot. Create, I think. And then title should be my feature or whatever I want the title to be. And body should be I'm too lazy to write descriptions. And now the pull request is created and we can go back to Jenkins and see what's going on. And here it is, the PR is already running and it is doing something. It is actually not something, it is executing all the steps that are either generic or specific to pull requests. This will take a couple of seconds, so I might fast forward. Okay, it's almost finished and we can see here all the steps. We can here see the steps of the build stage, the steps of the test stage. It deployed, it ran simulation of tests, it destroyed whatever was deployed so that we do not waste resources, and the deploy stage was skipped because we configured the job to run that stage only if there are changes to the mainline. Now let's see the repository itself. GH repo view, and then we want to do it in web. And here we are. This is the repository. This is the pull request that I created. And the pull request is actually that one, my feature. Now let's merge this pull request and see what will Jenkins do next. There we are. I'm going to delete the branch. I do not like leaving the dangling branches. And now if you go back to Jenkins, it should execute whatever is set to be executed whenever we push something to the mainline. Here we are. It is running the build. The same Jenkins file or same job, except that the job is set to do certain things only under certain conditions. So let's fast forward to the end of this as well. That's it, it's already done. And let's double check whether everything is indeed working. Now, if everything worked as expected, we should have the application, the new release of the application running in production. And we can double check that by opening it in browser. This is the address that I pre-configured for the application in production. So if I open it, and here we are, we can see that it is indeed a new release because this text is what I just changed in the source code, Jenkins in KFS in 2021. So we have a new release deployed to production as a result of merging the pull request to the mainline. Now, this was a quick tutorial of kind, but mostly for the sake of showing you how I would use Jenkins in 2021, which is not much different than how I would use it 5 years ago, which might be a good thing or a bad thing. I'm not sure. Anyways, let's talk about Jenkins. Let's talk about what we experienced and many of the things that we didn't experience in this demo. And here my thoughts whether you should use Jenkins or look for something else. So Jenkins, 15-year-old project, loved by many, hated by some, or the other way around, I'm not sure. Anyways, let's talk about Jenkins in 2021. Now, some of the pros and cons might apply to you, some might not. So you need to choose which ones do you care about and which ones you don't. And I'm going to start with problematic parts or cons. Jenkins does not scale. It cannot scale. I mean, depends actually. It can scale builds. It can have anything between zero and thousands of concurrent builds. But Jenkins Master, the engine, does not scale. You can have only one replica of a Jenkins Master or the engine that drives all those builds or those jobs. You could run multiple instances of Jenkins, but they're all separated. That's not scaling really. That's having two Jenkins instances, which is not the same as having two replicas of a Jenkins instance that shares the load so that we can have higher capacity. It is based on old architecture. The architecture of Jenkins did not really change much since 10 years ago or something like that, since it was created, more or less. We are getting new plugins that are extending capabilities. And by the way, everything is a plugin in Jenkins. So we got like Blue Ocean some maybe 3, 4, 5 years ago that changed the look and feel of part of Jenkins. We got a plugin to run builds in Kubernetes. And that plugin, by the way, was one of the first implementations and maybe even first true implementation of running pipeline builds in Kubernetes. And it works fairly well, to be honest. In any case, it is very old architecture, and that reflects on many aspects of Jenkins, which you as a user might not notice right away, but they are there. Plugins are one of those things that made Jenkins skyrocket in popularity. Everybody created a plugin. We got hundreds or thousands of plugins. And through those plugins, we can do almost anything we want. Anything anyone could imagine is likely doable through a plugin. But managing plugins is a nightmare. Even the limited amount of plugins required to run Jenkins core, plus the plugins that were included in the basic Helm chart that I installed, were already deprecated before I even installed it. And then there were other plugins that had security issues or were not up to date and so on and so forth. And that is on a very small sample of a fresh installation of the latest Helm chart. So the latest Helm chart has deprecated or problematic plugins or not up to date plugins. Now imagine what happens when over time you increase the number of plugins. You need a person dedicated just managing Jenkins instance. And that's a lot of work and a painful work, to be honest, because you never know whether upgrading one plugin will result in some other plugin or something else in Jenkins to fail because they're not compatible and so on and so forth. Plugins are a nightmare. And then we have shared libraries. Shared libraries are amazing if you used only Jenkins or if you compare Jenkins with Bamboo or TeamCity. They allow us to get part of the repetitive code in pipelines and put them somewhere else so that we do not repeat ourselves too much in pipelines. They're extremely powerful. Shared libraries are probably the most powerful implementation of something like that in any of the similar tools. But they are outdated as well. Today, shared libraries should be containers or container images, maybe a few YAML files or a few scripts and so on and so forth, and definitely not Groovy. But that is not directly fault of Jenkins, but more of an abuse of Jenkins. People go crazy with shared libraries just as they go crazy with pipelines and forget that most of the things should be done outside of the tools like Jenkins or any other pipeline tool. We should create scripts instead of shared libraries. We should make sure that everything is executable and decoupled from pipeline tools. And then we should use pipelines only as orchestrators of automation done somewhere else. But many do not approach it in that way. They abuse Jenkins and then they got something very difficult to manage. However, Jenkins is inviting that abuse, so it is fostering wrong practices. It is fostering doing everything inside Jenkins instead of actually decoupling automation itself from orchestration of that automation, which is what pipelines should be doing. Jenkins also has many advantages, and the biggest one is the one that I already mentioned as a problem, and that is that it can do anything anyone wants. Now, whether such a tool, a pipeline tool like Jenkins, should do anything anyone would ever imagine is a separate question. But if you're into crazy things, you can do them with Jenkins, and it's more likely that you can do them with Jenkins than any other tool. Jenkins is also one of the first tools of that kind to really, truly support Kubernetes. Jenkins is not Kubernetes native. Jenkins itself is not designed to run properly in Kubernetes. It is just something put on top of Kubernetes. But Jenkins jobs running in Kubernetes work for many years now, and they're still working better than in many tools of a similar kind. So Jenkins builds were one of the first CI/CD pipeline type of builds made to run in Kubernetes, and they still work exceptionally well. But Jenkins itself is not really made to run in Kubernetes. I already mentioned a couple of reasons in console. Jenkins, not Kubernetes native. Jenkins builds, amazing. They work amazingly well in Kubernetes. Jenkins has massive community and massive documentation. You can find a solution for any problem you might be facing. If you need a suggestion how to do something, you Google it, you find thousands of results. If you have an issue, you Google it, you find thousands of results. It has such a massive community that it cannot be compared with any other similar tool. Now, truth be told, you will face more issues with Jenkins than many other tools, but when the issues occur, you're more likely to find solutions for Jenkins than for any other tool. And then there is the issue of innovation. And I'm not now referring to innovation of Jenkins itself, but pipelines in general. For many years, pipelines stopped innovating. All the pipelines, at least from user perspective, are more or less the same. We can be fighting whether we are using YAML or JSON or this or that to define pipelines. We can be discussing whether YAML is better than Groovy or than DSL or than JSON or whatever format the tool is using. But pipelines are the same everywhere. We have steps executed sequentially or in parallel, and they're just running somewhere, and that somewhere today is Kubernetes. And more or less every single pipeline tool is the same. Truth be told, some are easier, some are harder, some are more user-friendly, some are less user-friendly, but those are just evolutions of the same concepts. Nobody that I know of is innovating, at least not seriously, in that space. And that means that Jenkins pipelines are not that different from other types of pipelines. Unless you dislike Jenkins DSL, which has its problems, ups and downs. Anyways, pipelines in Jenkins are more or less the same as pipelines everywhere. The real problem, the real issue with Jenkins is maintenance. It is not that much issue from user perspective. From developer's perspective, you write Jenkins file instead of writing CircleCI something or Argo workflow something, and that ends up more or less the same. The problem Jenkins has is maintenance. Whomever is making sure in your organization that Jenkins is up and running, that it is up to date, that it doesn't have vulnerabilities, and so on and so forth, is having a really hard time. So should you use Jenkins in 2021 or not? Should you use it as a pipelines type of solution for doing things inside Kubernetes? I'm not sure. It's very difficult to answer because on one hand, you might have a lot of investment in Jenkins, and then you might be wondering whether it's worthwhile moving that investment and reinvesting in something else. Jenkins pipelines are not that different than pipelines of other tools. The major question is how much it costs you to maintain Jenkins rather than whether it is better or worse than other tools from user perspective. Hey, and before you leave, let me know if you would like me to show you an example of doing GitOps with Jenkins or something else, something more concrete with Jenkins, or let me know whatever you want me to do in one of the next videos. I'm taking your comments seriously, and I'm going through all of them and fulfilling all the wishes. Jenkins is one of those wishes.